गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन, वेलकम टू अनदर बीएमए एपिसोड ऑफ वेनसडे वेबिनार्स। द वेनसडे वेबिनार्स आर स्पेशली नेम्ड एज द वेनसडे विजडम वेबिनार्स, वेयर टॉपिक्स दैट हेल्प यू टू ग्रो बियॉन्ड द टेक्निकल एंड द रेगुलर आर एड्रेस्ड। टुडे वी हैव विद अस Rashmi Sharma, ma'am, who has got more than 35 years of experience in doing various activities and who has actually evolved into what is called as a mindfulness teacher. Okay. She's been into behavioral change and leadership training as well for some time. She is the director of Gyan Rashmi Training Center. And we welcome her to be able to engage with us. Just to briefly tell you a little bit more about her, she's been in training for almost 15 plus years now. And she has done, she's a master trainer for the National Skills Development Corporation, Government of India. Sorry, Nimesh. Nimesh bhai, I muted you because I thought that it will help others to be able to. So, as I said, Rashmi ji has been a trainer at the National Skills Development Corporation of India, which is a Government of India initiative. She's also been a master trainer for the CBSE schools, especially in soft school skills of communication, of time management, of being able to do various activities which are related to building one's own personality. She's also a special coach for stress and anxiety management, which is so much more critical nowadays, considering that the students need help to cope with the stress that they go through. By education, she's a B.Ed., M.Com., and an MBA. And she has also done certification courses in gender equity with the United Nations Women's Organization and the British Council. She's a life member of BMA and she has been the former principal of an NGO which empowers women through its name called Durga Shakti. Today, Rashmi ma'am is going to talk to us about the three different aspects of mindfulness. One is basically understanding what is the meaning of mindfulness. Two, she's going to delve into how mindfulness is a tool for growth and peace. And finally, she's going to be able to share with us how mindfulness, okay, is a leadership skill that can help you become more self-aware, build relationships, and influence effectively. So without trying to cut and take further more time, I welcome Rashmi ma'am to take over and share with all of us the experience and learning that she's gained over the last 3.5 decades. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. And thank you everyone who has joined and taken out their valuable time to be here with me. As Sir Al already shared that mindfulness, we talk about a lot of things these days and how we understand, how we perceive mindfulness. All of us have a different definition and experience in the mindfulness in various occasions. So I'll just would like to share my screen here. It's not a very vast knowledge that I'm sharing and it's very recently, not many, old experience into just 4 years of experience in studying and practicing mindfulness on myself and seeking the how effective it can be for various things in aspects of our life. So I just keep talking about mindfulness to people because it is a helpful tool in the hands of any person who is going through maybe into any profession, or they might be having their personal issues, or as a normal person, wherever you, whatever kind of life we are living, mindfulness is always an aid to be keep us, give us a ha some moments of happiness and peace. Sir, I cannot see. Yeah, this is here. Think you can see my screen here.
Yes, we can.
Okay. Thank you. So, this time what I thought about that mindfulness, because we are increasingly focusing on that as a leader, what we do in our organizations or leading our life, we understand processes, we understand practices, we understand procedures, we understand practices. And but we the most important aspect of any organization is people. So understanding of people is of immense importance for any person, in fact, not only apart the leader. So here I just want to see that, okay. So introduction, I would like to say that mindfulness is not one part of the mindfulness is, as Shell has shared, is a field of knowledge. So what we understand by mindfulness, when we talk about, okay, something, somebody is practicing mindfulness or be mindful, so what exactly it means? So in short and brief, I will just go through this journey, that what exactly the meaning of the mindfulness is then, and then how we, most of the time when we talk about mindfulness, some one word comes to our mind, breathing exercise or meditation. So yes, of course, mindfulness is a very good tool for our spiritual growth, and it tells us, how we can be in the present moment, leave apart the sadness, griefs of our past events, or be worried about the future events that are coming our life and actually disturbing us in the present moment. And with practice of mindfulness, being in the present, how we can develop our inner peace that gradually, keeps us calm in the turbulent times. The third aspect, which we actually, this has been recently talked about, that how it can help as a leader of some organization or leading your life as a leader. So here, so it is the practical aspect that how we can use mindfulness in our day-to-day activities, working with people, and as especially when we are leading an organization. So how we become, most important thing that how we become a self-aware leader. So when we see that, and how we can have the relationships and awareness of others, and how, because a leader is one who can influence the behavior of people. This is one of the most important aspect of the work or the responsibility of the leader. So that is how we can influence the other people behavior in their thought process, and to lead an organization in peace and harmony towards achieving its goal. So when we, so if we see that the mindfulness, it has, three layers if we talk about. One layer is we normally talk about, okay, which we comes to our mind, that okay, it is the upper layer, the surface layer of the mindfulness, that whenever we say something, okay, this is practicing mindfulness, it is just somebody is talking about the stress, general guidance or advice is okay, you can practice mindfulness, living in the present moment, or have some breathing exercises, or put your attention towards the surroundings and environment. So when we talk, it's a very surface level conversation about, without going into deep and understanding what exactly is and how it is actually helps us. So when we talk about as a definition, so we say that, okay, yes, mindfulness is a mind and body approach to life, and it helps us to relate to our experiences with more accuracy and clarity. So it is not only becoming present, or it is also using taking our experiences more mindfully. So full of mind is also one of the meaning I consider for the mindfulness. So we seek with clarity what actually our experiences mean to us and what else lies there behind them, which we have not been able to see or go through. So mindfulness involves being acutely aware of our thoughts, emotions, and actions. So it means that we are present. It also means that we are present in each moment and we are paying close attention to what's exactly happening right now. No, so most of the time what happens, our mind wanders here and there. So going into the past events, regretting something, feeling ashamed or sadness about the past events that happened to us, or maybe we are imagining our future predictions. Okay, well, this is going to happen, then this will lead to me to that stage. So it's about, sometimes it makes us anxious or overwhelmed with emotions. So when we are into the present moment, when we are mindful, we can actually observe what is from the outside, that what is going inside at this moment of myself, what emotions are there, what the thoughts I am thinking, and if I am taking some action, I am presently in the present moment in this action I'm taking mindfully, or my mind is absent-mindedly, or I'm somewhere else and doing the task here without any thoughts or being present into the process of any task I'm doing for that. So when it starts with our perception, but because we are, normally look so many things about around us, our environment. We are sitting somewhere, we are always maybe looking or thinking about something. So most of the time what happens, our observation is the most important part when it comes to mindfulness. But how we observe things? We observe through our eyes only. That means on a very surface level, and we are not paying any attention to it. We are not taking something out of it. We are not observing in detail. And at a glance, we can say, we see and we forget what is there. Then we are, as a human, we are meaning making machine. So what happens the next, if we have a pause and look a little deeper, observe something a little bit seriously or in detail, what we do? We just talk about, okay, what is the reason behind it? Make assumptions. What the person is doing? What was the meaning of that? How? Why he did said that as to me? Why he was looking in that? I can see his eyes. That was staring at me. It was not a looking. Or this thing? Why this thing is object is there? Who has put it there? People are so careless about the things. They do not live an organized life. So a lot of things may happen whenever we look into our environment, and very little focus gives a rise to many thoughts in our minds. We think about the thing that belongs to some person, kiska hoga, kaisa hoga. So all these come to our mind. And but when we are deeply concerned about certain things, the most important aspect of mindfulness, that how we see anything, any event, any person, object with the purpose of understanding what actually lies behind it. What is the real, not the assumption, but the real understanding of something. If I meet a people, if I see that, okay, that person is not properly dressed or looking lost somewhere, so I will just not say, okay, that is absent-minded person. I will not judge the person. I will not put the label. But what I will do, I will try to understand the reason behind the lost look of that person. Is that person is disturbed by something? And in appropriate way, I would really try to understand that anything that is happening within the life of that person, if that person is comfortable enough to share it with me. The same thing happens when we have listened to some events that happen, somebody is sharing the experience or talking about somebody else. So sometimes what happens, if I'm not happy with my boss, I go to my colleague and I just take it as a, okay, I'm talking about some negative things about the person, how that person behaves, or this is not the right way, this wasn't the right way of treating me, or there might maybe be some polite ways of saying certain things. So rather than making judgment about this person or saying something, because we most of the time we become judgmental about other person. So why were they were there? How did they were not dressed properly? They were not behaving properly, or this was not the way of greeting a person. A lot of things happen, but when we listen and look at the thing by with a deep sense of understanding, actually, what's going on inside there, why a person was late, rather than commenting on this person is always late or blaming or labeling that person as a latecomer, there can be a certain, conversation, or we can at least tell ourselves, oh, there might be some reason behind it, because normally, intentionally, nobody comes late. Nobody, wants to be pointed out as a latecomer. So there might be some reason. It is better I talk to that person personally, and I will try to understand what was the trouble the person was facing and what made that person to be not on time at that place. So if these are the things when we do, when we look at the things even without giving them a meaning, without labeling them, and trying to understand and observe deeply, is actually the real mindfulness, that okay, I am looking the things with my mindfulness. I am present there. I am totally aware of so many things that can happen, and I am not taking out, pointing out one thing that I feel with satisfies me or gives me a kind of pleasure to pointing out to someone else that, okay, wow, that person is late. Now everybody will, he will get some reprimand for that or something. So I'm not going into that kind of imaginations or little pleasures, which are, though, may give me some pleasure, but they are in negative in their nature. So when I realize that what is positive and what is negative, and when I'm looking at certain things, how present I am, how different deeply I am caring about the different aspects of anything. So that is the real observation, looking with understanding and with mindfulness. Then, what are the major components of our mindfulness? So there are three major components. One is that attention. Our attention diverts here and there. So one thing is that how much attention I'm paying to certain things. Am I fully present there? I am attentive to that. If I'm listening to somebody, how attentive I am, how attentive I am on the task I'm doing right now, or I am, just for the sake of I am doing it, I don't have any heart to that. I don't have any attention to that. And which means that what when I'm going to talk to somebody and I'm going to meet somebody, what is my total attention? My mind is wandering. Why I am going there? This person is that kind of person that will waste my time. I know what's going to happen there. So that means my attention is on my imaginations. That means my attention is to my focus is somewhere else, not to the person I'm going to meet, not to the task I'm going to deliver right now. So my attention is the being attentive is most of the most important aspect of being mindfulness. If you can't be attentive to certain things, you can't pay attention, that means your mind is wander, and that is not mindfulness. Second thing is intention. What intention I am, my intentions behind of certain things. So we say that we all have positive intentions. Nobody has any intention of harming anybody. So nobody gets up in the morning with the thought, oh, I'm going to make the life troublesome for this person today. Let me see how that person smiles today. I am there. I will just put everything, create havoc for that person. This is my intention. I'm going to, nobody gets up with these kinds of thoughts. We all get up with the thought, okay, yes, the way, because we are all positive people, we want to help other people, we want to be good, better for everyone. And but so intention is the most important point. So whenever we see something negative happen in our life, or somebody says hurt us, we feel hurt or something. So it's always important that what we pay attention to the intention of the person, because when it comes to us, I say something and the other person feels offensive. The next moment I will say, oh, it wasn't my intention. My intention was very pure. I didn't want to hurt you. I didn't want to insult you. You know, so it just to see, look at, maybe my words were not proper at the time, but my intention was very clear. But what happens when some other person hurts us? We just become opposite. We don't pay any attention to the intention. Rather than what we do, but we just go believe the words that person, okay, that intentionally harmed me. So there are many times I know it was done intentionally. So whenever we say these types of words for any other person, if we are aware of mindfulness, if we know that, okay, we are mindful, then we will catch this word coming out of our own mouth, okay, that intentions are always pure. Nobody intentionally does it until unless, you know, there is some reason behind that. And the purpose should be to understand that reason that actually makes that person to intentionally do some harm. That is the attitude. What attitude I adopt when I follow or practice mindfulness. So attitude of mindfulness is we follow non-judgment, you know. So we do not have any kind of judgment. We just merely watch, you know, without any offensive or being offensive or being appraising or kind of labeling. Whatever happens, be just an observer from a distance. So this is objectively observing certain things, not taking it personally. We just want to be okay, or not labeling it, because the purpose is not to judge. The purpose is to understand. Purpose is to connect. So see an observing thing from a distance. That means it is not, I am not involved into that, and I can look the thing with it from a distance and being non-judgmental. But then the other thing is that patience, you know, letting things unfold in their own time. Sometimes we become impatient if something is not happening, why we are expecting some results to come, and maybe my boss has promised me some promotion in coming months. And I become impatient. Okay, when this boss is going to announce that promotion, and we become so fearful of other things, like, you know, oh, somebody may say some bad thing, negative things about me to the boss. Meanwhile, if he doesn't announce the promotion as soon as possible, somebody may spoil the mind of the boss, and he may, you know, can change the decision. So unnecessarily, we are losing our patience. And also losing the peace of mind. We are going into a lot of worries. We are going into a lot of, you know, anxieties, just because our mind is not, you know, wandering here and there, focusing on the negative thing. And then what the other thing is that we have to look the things at a fresher's mind. That means as a beginner person, oh, something, exclamatory, oh, this happened to me. And trust, no limitations, living our own life and honoring your feelings, intuitions and wisdom. So is that we trust whatever comes to our mind. Sometimes we have positive feelings, sometimes we might have some fears or whatever my wisdom is. So I am living my life and with trust over it, that what is happening, what I am doing, what I am thinking, I have full confidence on that it is, you know, I'm improving every day. I'm not the best. I'm not the perfect person, but I am improving each day. That trust is very, very important. And sometimes we feel, okay, non-striving. Mindfulness is not doing. It doesn't mean that we are sitting quietly waiting for something to happen patiently. And, okay, I'm not. Striving means here I'm not, you know, just running after certain things. I'm taking a peaceful steps. I am slowing down myself, my thought process. You know, people say, okay, strive for that, you know, to be better. Yes, striving is important, but it is, you know, not in that way that it becomes a negative aspect. It impacts our, you know, peace of mind. We are not calm. We are getting frustrated easily. Oh, it's not. And we are losing patience. As we have talked about, the patience is an important attitude when we talk about this mindfulness. So when we strive impatiently, that is a negative word. But striving means that peacefully, with wisdom and mindfully, taking one step after another so that we can achieve our goal. Because what actually life is all about, we all want to be successful. Each of us have different kinds of goals which we want to achieve. Then acceptance, you know. So that means that how things really are. You know, my expectations and imaginations can be different from the reality. So what is the reality? I have to accept it. Okay, this is the situation, because in any situation, adversity, whatever happens, we have to accept that, okay, this happened. Then only our mind will not be overwhelmed with emotion. That only the peace will come, where I can see the clear picture with a calm mind and can see, use my wisdom, that how I can come out of the adversity. If it is the adversity, if it is an opportunity, how can I positively use that for my own growth and the benefit of all others? So this is very, very important attitude. And the most important attitude is of letting go. We cling to past. We cling to whatever happened once in our life. You know, keep on thinking that somebody, it was telling, he refused to me my proposal. Oh, that I will never, next time, wherever I go, carry that with me, that refusal, that rejection. So we do not want to let go of the things. And there might be some, you know, some possessive people of the possessions of our material aspect. They have the very, very old, the more, you know, it's a 20-year table I have in my house. And nobody can touch that table. I have become so attached to that table. It's a wooden table. It's not, you know, not, I don't want to give it. It may be not useful in any way because it is so much of torn off now. But I will not let it go. I will not throw out the old things which are not used nowadays. So that is another type of clinging to things, that I am keeping my house. I'm made it as a storehouse, as a godown, because a lot of things are there. I'm buying new things, but I'm not letting go of the old thing. So same thing happened. I have new things. I have new experience, but I am not letting go of the old experiences from my mind. And what happens? My mind becomes, you know, suffocated, clutter of so many things which are there. We can't see clearly if there is so much, you know, clutter is there already in the mind. We cannot think properly. So many emotions come and down, go. So it's important that we learn to let go of the things or the people or the events that happened to us in the past. And then when we talk about mind, it is not, I'm just talking about in a general term, but everything is actually contributing to the next step. So when we talk about, okay, there, as I told you, there are different layers. So there are different dimensions also. One of them is the internal, that how I relate to myself. What are my values? How confident I am about taking my decisions, doing my job, work, or whatever knowledge I have. And then is the relational dimension. That means I cannot, humans are social animals. We need interactions with other people. We cannot live in isolation. So I have to get in touch with other people. So relational dimension is also important, that how I relate to other people, how I conduct with different people. Am I behaving same to all people, or I take consideration of the fact that this person needs requirements are different, that person's needs are different. I am considerate or caring about all these things. I'm paying attention to these things. I'm being mindful how I behave different people as the requirement of the time and that situation also demand different kind of conduct. Do I pay attention to those things? So how I relate socially and relationally with other people. Then the third is that developmental dimension, that how much I have grown out of my life, how you know, I am growing from the past, and how making myself, what kind of a person I want to be in future, and what I'm doing to be that person. So it is when we, how I relate to my past will impact my today, will impact my tomorrow's experiences. Because whatever we experience in our life, they create a memory, and our memories are always with us. So whenever we go through the same situation, whenever we go to the same event, taking same decision in the present moment, If this past events, they impact us. They have their influence. So that is why letting go was one of the most important aspect attitude of the mindfulness. And then there might have happened some negative events in the past. But the main thing is that how I relate to it this past now. Am I carrying the baggage of that? I am, influencing by the past rejection. Oh, once I have rejected, I will always be getting rejections. Or I can say, okay, that happened in the past sometime. But there are new things. I am not the same person today. I can create new experiences for myself. So this is how I can grow out of my old mentality and develop a new personality, new traits in myself. So these are the three dimensions of the mindfulness, with where everyone goes through. And if we are practicing mindfulness, that means we have to understand that all these three aspects of mindfulness. Then when we talk about, now this is all the relational knowledge as per the knowledge aspect, okay, what areas it deals with, what exactly mindfulness is. But then comes for the how I use the mindfulness practices. Here comes the tools and techniques which we normally talk about. Okay, we say, let us, what we need to do. It's not a very big thing to do. This is something not a very, kind of a weightlifting practice or something, not a rocket science you have to practice to make a rocket. It's very simple techniques and tools that you can adopt in your life to practice mindfulness for your spiritual growth, for your peace of mind. This is for, okay, I want to remove stress out of my life. I get very easily anxious and frustrated. I am very short-tempered. I get angry on a very small thing. So people suggest, okay, one of the tools, meditate. You meditate. You practice mindfulness. That will help you to do that. So how we do practice mindfulness in our for our spiritual growth, for our peace of mind, or to be more clear in our present moment. So it's very simple. Set aside a time when you can have some exercise that can give you bring you that, okay, you are into the present moment. So it may be in the beginning you can have 5 minutes time in the morning time, or if you have relaxed peace of status, then you can have in the evening time, wherever you feel, whenever of the day of the time of the day that you feel comfortable, you are not bombarded by the different responsibility calls and all, some peaceful part. And then you sit there, accept the present moment. And the other thing you can practice is that you can be in the present moment and say that, okay, I accept what is the reality. Is that something I expected didn't happen? Didn't happen. So I cannot, blame other people, keep on throwing, okay, people are not good, nobody helped me. If somebody, this person would have helped me, I would have achieved my this goal, I have accept, got this. So no, we are just accepting this is the reality. My relationships are not good. Okay, that is the reality. I cannot deny this reality, or neither I can blame other person to create all the kind of havoc in my life. So this is the reality that, okay, I am, first of all, I have to see that where I stand, what is my surrounding. So I have to accept this is the present. Then let your judgments go. And then the more judgmental we are, more comparisons we do with other people, what happens? We lose our peace of mind. So the less judgmental we become, it's okay, the other person. Why should I think about it's overthinking, being judgmental of everything? And this is really, really, every person has, not about others, but on our own self also. We are very judgmental, even more judgmental about our own actions and words, what we should. Oh, I would have done that. It was so bad of me. It was so stupid of me. So what we do, I judge myself, I blame myself, I label myself, and then observing the present as it is, accept that mind wander. And whenever we have sit for a meditation, many people say that we can't focus. My thoughts keep on coming. I do not know where I, lose the attention on my breathing or whatever exercise I'm doing, meditation I'm doing. It's okay that your mind will wander. The only thing is that you become aware once again that, okay, you are into the process of Meditation, it is not very difficult. So how we do it, how we regulate ourselves, and how we, you know, create focus and attention for self-regulation. So very simple technique in mindfulness is focus on your breath. So I said, set aside some time. Don't judge yourself. Don't judge anybody else on that time. Except this is the situation. Sit quietly and focus on your breathing. So there are different types of breathing. People say the square breathing, where you have to, like, you know, breathe in for 4 seconds, breathe, then hold for 4 seconds, then again you breathe out for 4 seconds, and you then again hold for 4 seconds. Or whatever, you can have a deep breathing. You don't want to make it complicated. So very simple. Relax your body totally. You know, do can take out all the tensions from your body parts, your shoulders, your neck, your back, and then start breathing, deep breathing. And focus on your breath only, how it, you, when you inhale, how it goes inside, when you exhale, how it goes out of your body. So it is, you know, focus of body plus mind, and your spirit also, because something, our consciousness is there. Spirit is also known as the consciousness. And what happens? Our mind, of course, it will wander. Some thought will come. My eyes may open. I can hear some sound somewhere. And even if it is a sound of a bird, my mind can go to the, okay, where the bird is sitting, that tree is there. And, you know, it's a train of my thoughts that will, you know, drag me. I do not know to which place. So the moment I become aware that, okay, my mind has wandered, it has gone to, dragged out by the thoughts, I can redirect my attention on the breathing. So this is how I regulate myself gradually. It's not one day practice. You have to practice it all over, you know, every day, to, you know, at least 5 minutes, 7 minutes, whatever time you have for this. And then you can have focus on yourself. And this is a so simple exercise that wherever you are, whatever you are doing, for 2 minutes, whenever something disturbs you, you can just sit quietly and pay attention to your breathing. The moment you pay attention to your breathing, gradually you will see that mind starts getting calm and becoming peaceful. And the other practices are also there. When we say exercise sometime, you know, go to gardens, look at the flowers, nature, plants, or you can observe sky when it is full of clouds, how the clouds are moving from one place to another place. Or you can go for a mindful walk. When you walk, you can see how your body is moving, how your the earth is touching to your earth. And then you pay attention to your 5 senses at this present moment. You look around, what things you are seeing, what sounds you are listening, and, you know, what smells are there, how is the temperature, is it hot, is it cold, or is it a windy environment? So you know, this kind of attention, how you perceiving the present moment around you, that your environment, that is also where you can, it's a moment of no thought, thoughtlessness. And then, because when we are so used to listening sounds different ways, it is very, very soothing to pay attention to the silence, because every sound emerges from the silence and, you know, comes, fades away into the silence. And the same thing happens with the objects around. We pay attention to the object, but there are space, a lot of space between the one object to another. We do not say that, okay, this is the space also we pay attention to. And then full body awareness. I start from my toe to my head, paying attention part, you know, gradually to different parts of my body. That also relaxes, and that practice also can. So this is, when we practice these regularly, all these techniques and tools, they help us in becoming more mindful, giving peace of mind, and they help us in our spiritual growth. So that is the another aspect. We are not focusing on our problems in this process. We are not focusing on some particular situation that this situation will be solved. If I do all these activities or any one of activities on a regular basis. But the thing is that, okay, my overwhelm feelings, they calm down. They are not there to disturb. If I am, you know, anxious, my anxiety will calm down. I will see clearly because my mind is at peace. I can think properly. I can be, when I'm in anger, I cannot, I will always be negative. But I keep away my anger. Do some small, short exercise. What will happen? Then after that, my anger goes away. I can see things more clearly. So that is how mindfulness brings peace to us. And gradually we feel that now the things don't disturb us as easily as they used to in the past when we were not following the practices of mindfulness. So there are these main of the tools and techniques which we can apply, we can talk, and we can practice in our, and none of this is going to help you instant. These are all, gradual practices. So even if we are mentally disturbed, if we, a lot of things happen and we have concentration problem, memory problem, and the children, they don't are not they concentrate on studies, can't remember. So they also can practice mindfulness practices. They can follow these, and this will improve their memory also, their their concentration also. And as in the teenage specifically, we see that the teenagers are very hyper-tempered. They are very led, easily led by emotion. The mindful practices to the children will help them to stay calm and peaceful. So other thing is that this is a small exercise when you can, be aware of helping somebody else to be aware. You can ask the question, where is my body right now? I'm sitting on a sofa, I'm on a bed, or it's a chair, or where is I'm in the balcony or bedroom or drawing room. Where is my mind right now? I can think, okay, what I was thinking, my thoughts were for tomorrow's breakfast, what I am going to do, what is the file need to be submitted to my boss. Oh, what are you fully focused on right now? Am I focused on the present moment, or am I focused on certain other things that can have, disturbing? Or what factors are influencing you right now? There is some deadline coming that is impacting you, or some the that need to meet somebody, some appointment is there, or you are going for interview. So there is some things which factor that might be influencing you right now. What is the most important thing at this moment for you that leading you towards certain action? So these some of the questions can also help you becoming in the present, mindful of the present moment right now, right here. Then when we come to the different aspects of mindful, when we talk about it's when we use it in our life, not leave apart practicing and all that thing, the third layer comes that in very deep level, it helps us in our day-to-day experiences, it helps us in our family relations, our business, our profession, and most importantly, leading my own life, myself, in a very positive and calm way. So here I would just like, when we talk about specifically, because today's session is about that how mindfulness has become a 21st century leadership skill. As I shared in the beginning, that we have to focus on people skill. This is one of the most important skill of the coming this century. That leave apart understanding processes, procedures, policies, practices. Most important thing that human resources, we have to connect to them, we have to understand them, and we that is how why we talk about emotional quotient, we talk about social quotient of the people, because how we understand people. So most important thing is that how I understand myself, how aware of I am of my own self, because without knowing myself I cannot see the other people, And then I have to understand my relational aspect. I have to understand the people whom I'm dealing with. I'm talking to maybe how my organization works, how many people are there, and how do they do. So when I talk about self-awareness, the same actually applies to the others also. So I'll not take the separate thing because they are same. And then when we understand people, when we understand ourselves, when we know how to relate other people, it's very easy to win the trust of the people. And when they trust us, we can influence. So they get influenced also. So it's easy for a leader to influence people by winning the trust of the people. You know, if we win the heart of the people, they will give us their minds as well. So how we connect other people, how we understand their situation. And the moment you find a person who understands you, the moment, even if it is somebody who you are traveling with and you are talking about for the first time some problem, and that person looks into the directly and understand the real cause, and you become so, oh, gaga about that. Okay, this person, we really understood in the first meeting. I really appreciate this person. You are all praise for that person. So how important it is that somebody understands us. And if you can become a leader like that, so see that how people will when are going to trust you. So here I would just take something from the emotional intelligence by Daniel Goleman, that where he talks about the different dimensions of awareness. It's about social awareness, self-awareness, and motivation, and how we get motivated, how I get regulate, how can I regulate myself. All this comes under the relationship management. Maybe it is the relationship with myself, or maybe the relationship with other people. So here we say there are two aspects, especially we say the competencies, which is personal competency and the social competency. The personal means that my ability, that how I am aware of my emotion and how well I have learned to manage them or control them or maybe use them on a particular way. So first thing, it includes two things: self-awareness. I know what's happened. I accurately perceive and understand my emotion. I'm a short-tempered person. What are my emotional traits are? What triggers me? And then I know how I manage and my behavior, those do not impact my general behavior with people, how I deal. The other thing is that how my I'm able to understand the moods, behavior, infatuations of other people. There we have important relations, maybe personal or maybe my professional one. So if I understand the emotions and behaviors of others, if a person is behaving in a particular way, I know what can be the reason behind it. And if I do not know properly, I can talk to that person to have a real understanding behind that. And I can that when we have such kind of conversations with other people to with the purpose of understanding their causes of their behavior, what's going on in their life, to understand their situation, we manage relationship in a better way, and we impact people in a better way and can work with them more effectively. So this is actually the foundation of mindfulness. Because if we do not have that understanding, that awareness, mindfulness will not be, it will not be of much help. So the difference between the social emotional intelligence and mindfulness is that we talk about, when we talk about emotional intelligence, we talk about a general thing. When we talk about mindfulness, we talk about the present moment, at this moment, this person standing in front of me, something, what that person is going through at this moment. Okay, so it's not about in detail and this long-term view. It is not a general state view, generalization of behavior, thoughts, and patterns, but it is at this present moment. So what is happening, what when I am aware of myself in the first moment, so I feel that what are my internal and external stimuli. What disturbs me internally, what thought, kind of thoughts I think most of the time, what if there are challenges that actually internally they disturb me, or they create a kind of anxiety in me, or what are the external things that actually just trigger me, somebody saying, using particular word, somebody talking about some situation or event that happened in the past or may happen in the future that disturbs me. Then awareness about my social interactions, that how do I conduct myself in the presence of other people at this moment, and awareness of past and future. What was my past and what is going, my future is going to be? Because I have told you that already, that I have shared it, that our memories of past experiences, They always remain in our minds and they always impact us. My past experiences come. So when most of the time, like, you know, say we affirmations and all that we talk about, okay, this will change, things will change, but we are doing many times, but no impact is coming because we are not letting go of our past. We are holding on to our past, you know. So I'm aware that, okay, these kind of bad memories or rejecting negative impact have even happened in my past. So there is no use in the present moment bringing them into this time. Is my past ruling my present moment? At this moment, what I'm thinking about, my future prospect, my positive outcomes I'm expecting from the future, the kind of person I'm going to become in the future, the changes I'm making myself and how they are going to reflect in my future persona, my identity, my growth level. So if I am thinking, if I am into this one, I'm aware of all these things. So what are the past events that hampering that future identity of myself, that I can be the person in the future, but something happened in the past is disturbing me, and how is disturbing me? How can I get rid of that situation? What things are there to help me if I have to take some professional help even, you know, for that I am I ready to take that? So all these awareness actually helps us, because my past, how it is, our, no matter what happens in the past, it impacts, and specifically what we have learned in our childhood, and then so all we have absorbed through our environment, and it still becomes a part of our personality, it still becomes a part of our decision making process, it still becomes a part of the kind of choices we make in the present time and will make in the future. So if we want to have the outcomes which actually are good for us, we are expecting them to happen, we have to keep on analyzing that, okay, how much past is present in this present moment, and that can impact my future. And of course, I have to be aware what thoughts I'm going, because every thought triggers a kind of feeling in me. If I have a thought of something negative, a word, somebody behaved me, you know, somebody got angry to me. If I recall that moment, the feelings will change. If I recall a moment somebody appreciated me, I think about the appreciation, or I think about the beautiful weather, my thoughts and my feelings will be different. So they are interconnected with each other. And what urges I have, what motivates me? So I first think is that how much aware of I am of myself. Because if I know, then only I can understand that how I behave with the other people, the way I behave. So why I say the words I say, why I do what I do. So that action. So there are certain things which we have to wonder about it, that whenever we are into other people's context as a leader, specifically when we are talking to people in our environment, so what kind of thoughts we, how we behave, what we do when we listen to other person, or we are in a meeting, or we are delivering something and we are want. So this is like, you know, whatever I have shared, as I told you, it's not about me. The stages as a leader I am going through, I must consider that the other person's situation is not the different, because we are all human. If I am not self-aware about my thoughts and feelings and emotions, there might be other people in my organization. They are not self-aware about that thing, those things. They do not know how they feel. They do not know the reason why they do the things they do. So if, you know, if we are going through this process, if we understand, okay, I understand my emotions and I know how to manage them, is the other person is also able to understand his or her emotions, what they feel, how they behave, how it impacts them, or are they able to manage that, those emotions, or they take it out into the open? and reaction, then they react rather than responding. So it's a two-faced coin. Whatever we develop on ourselves, whatever work we do on our improvement and growth as a leader, the same thing applies. If we are a mindful leader, we will apply the same thing to the others as well in the organization. We know that we are all human beings. We have the same feelings and emotions. We react the same way most of the time. Every negative happening impact us in a negative way. All of us, leave apart the leader or the clerk, is no two different thing, person at that time. They are the same way. So we have to think that, okay, heart and mind actually, you know, work in the same fashion. And there might be some, if I have some limiting beliefs, or there are certain my personal obstacles are there, there might be personal obstacles, obstacles for the other person as well. So once we look inside ourselves for that, it is being mindful that we look the same thing in the people around us. We are working with them, those people. You know, so we have to think about, okay, once if I was not self-aware, if I am I had used to make judgment, that means the other person might be judgmental, you know. So whenever we listen to the other person, so it is important that how I listen to other person, what are the things that go on my mind while I am listening to other person, while I am not able to focus 100% at give my total attention to the person who is talking to me. Same thing may happen. As a leader, when I say something to my colleagues or my subordinates, their mind may be going through all these things, like, you know, response rehearsal. Before listening to the whole of the story, whole of the thing, what my mind is doing. We try to create a response. Okay, let this person finish and I'm going to respond. I will say this. I will reply like this. So we actually not listening whatever being said to us. But what I am doing, I am just rehearsing my response. When the talk is over, what I am going to say, you know, how I am going to react, what my question will be after that, what question I am going to ask. So if these things go on, so that means I cannot understand what the other person is sharing with me. And I am not able to listen completely. Or when I am not listening, of course, I am not understanding. So this is not listening for understanding, but listening for the sake of listening, or rather than responding, reacting, and rehearsal. So, and then the other thing that hampers the listening is fact-finding into the conversation. So the same thing as a leader, if I do, the other person might do the same thing. So when we look at, go to this journey of self-awareness, we can be mindful that other person is still struggling with the obstacles. I am knowing, understanding them and trying to overcome them. And then judgmentalism. We make judgments about, you know, like, okay, this leader has come with some plan or some program to be conducted in the future. I know this person is not his own thought. Somebody in the, maybe have copied from his friends in the other organization. I know he's not worth thinking of that deeply. Might have seen some video and taken idea from that. So what I am doing, I'm judgment, become judging the person and doubting the authenticity of the person. You know, so the same thing might happen when I speak or somebody speaks, whatever goes in my mind can go into the mind of the other people also. And problem solving. This is another thing when we, without listening to the complete facts and situation, details of the situation, we start finding some solution, giving advices, you know. Somebody talks about, I have a back problem. What happens? Do we listen next to that? Our mind goes to the, what kind of advices I can give to that person. Okay, you should do this exercise. You should take this medicine, or that is very helpful. Do you go for a walk? So I'm not listening. Maybe there was something else. There was no pain at all to the person right now. He was just explaining to something related to back. But my mind will go to the different advices. I'm just wanting, okay, this medicine, this doctor, So many things come through. The same thing happens with people. Like whenever there is some conversation goes on, they find a problem, they try to find advice on the solution of the problem, and they are not understanding. They're listening to understand the other person. And when even as a leader, somebody talks about a problem, I as a leader also, okay, I have some problem in my, I cannot complete my targets on the this date. What are the time is fixed for that, and my deadline is coming. I have don't have enough time. I will not be able to do that. Before listening to what was the reason, how it happened, either we'll get angry without listening, or okay, keep and work overnight. You can do that. You can do that. So lots of advices will come to them. So as a leader, I have to think about both of the things. Okay, then imposing personal views. I know it's a position of authority. It is very, very common because we become so egoistic of our authority that we feel that our personal views are more important than the views and ideas and opinions of any other person. So we impose, we do not even, pay, if we don't give, first of all, we don't give time to listen to the other person, give an opportunity to speak, and if give opportunities. So we don't pay any attention. Oh, I know what are you going to say. Halfway we will stop that person. I know this is what happened. My view is, this is the perfect view. I know everything. I have taken into care, consideration every aspect. So what we do, we as a leader, we though it is very, very harmful practice, even in a normal life situation. But as a leader, rather than understanding, we grow, into more into imposing our personal views because our ego accumulates. Okay, I am under the authority. I have lot of experience. I have worked over, dominated such people. Thousands of people are working under me. How can I say something which is not correct? And then selective listening. We do not listen to the whole of the story. We listen because if our leader is, if somebody is talking about, so I will listen. I mean, that person is, okay, I want to leave. My mind is stuck on wants to leave. I will not listen that what the reason behind it, why this, okay, again you want to leave. Next, last time, last week you already have taken a leave. Why you need? So my mind is just listen one word, leave, and then I'm stuck there. So selective listening. Same thing happens when, as a leader, we speak to other people. So people listening to us, they listen to the part only which is relevant to their role. They won't listen to the whole story. And when we ask something, we get annoyed. Okay, you didn't listen to the whole story. So this is, as I said, that there are two sides of this coin, same coin. So if what happens inside me is already, it's, same thing happened to the other people whom I work with. They are, in my organization I deal with. And not only about that, okay, you are people who are under you, but the your boss also, if you are not at the highest position, you have the same tendencies there. So becoming mindfulness of all these tendencies which come is very, very important as a leader. So, being, and that comes when we are in the present moment. What's happening around me right now? So right now, right here, what it is there? So that knowledge, that awareness is very, very important. And that comes only through mindfulness. Because if we do not practice mindfulness, if we do not practice to be in the present moment, if we do not question ourselves, so what will happen that we will not notice that this goes on in my mind. I respond, rehearse a response. I find fact. I become judgmental. I try to solve problem rather than listening and understanding how I impose my personal views to others and how much I feel that, okay, my boss is imposing his personal view to me. It's not as if I do not know. I know better than my boss. Okay, so same thing happens when I'm speaking to somebody who is under me. So all that becomes, it comes when we in the present moment aware what's going on inside me at this present moment. Am I listening carefully? Am I paying attention? Am I there to understand the part or whatever is being said to me? What is the real meaning behind it? So all these things are when we pay consider, we pay attention to all that fact. then only, okay, that yes, I am there in the situation, we can have more deep understanding and we can find the more suitable solution to the situation or action. We can take a more accurate action, what is required at that moment. And then becoming conscious. So, you know, what happens is that once the first stage is that we have ego and we have a personal self and we are ignored first. We are ignorant about what's going on. Life is just we go away as destiny. It happens to me. Whatever God has decided will happen to me. And ego, I will not ask for help from anybody because I know it's God's will. Why I am to do that? So we are totally ignorant, like what is going on. There can be my hand into that. I can be responsible. Somebody, I will blame other people. I'll have my ego and I will not ask for any help. I will not, I will just be self-centered person. Okay, this has happened. This happens to me. I know I'm very unfortunate person. Then we become self-conscious person. Okay, we try to understand. Sorry, this felt. What happens that we become conscious of our own, what's going on in my mind, what are my thoughts, what my feelings are there. And then I become aware, I know that there are certain things, certain situations where I am, I can take decision, I can change those things, I understand the surrounding. The next level is that I look for more. So these are the steps when, you know, this any person in life goes through all these stages. And as a leader, we must be aware because maybe we have not followed all these stages or they were very short that we are not aware of. But a person goes through all these stages. As a leader, it's very important to understand that so that I can recognize that what stage the person is. A person is looking for more, wants to achieve more, grow, learn new skill. You know? And then we have a personal awakening. Okay, I have to become, so I can be better. There are some practices I can adopt in my life, which I practice. I can become a better person. Then we start on our personal journey of growth. We practice certain things. We learn new information. We open up ourselves. And we become more self-regulated, disciplined. And then we become more, when we take responsibility for our life, that, okay, these are my decisions, my choices that has created this situation. If I change my choices, if I change my decision, what will happen? I will change the outcome. So I feel independent of any, nobody is bothering me. And that independence brings me more creativity. I can think of new ideas. I can think of the new ways. Because I have to make new choices now. So I'm more creative, more risk taker, challenge the situation. And then living with mindfulness. The last stage is that, okay, I become mindful of every situation. I understand what's going on. So last three stages belong to a leader also. A leader can start from the last three one. And a normal person goes through all. And most of the time we find that the people are self-centered. They are ignorant. They just take destiny as it happens to me. And they are not even aware that what they're thinking is the wrong thinking. And they have a choice also. So from there, there might be some people in your organization as well. And if to who and from them, if you expect that they may be very creative, they're independent, they will live with mindfulness, they will work on their self-growth and self-development. So it's, it's your expectation is not correct at that. But whenever we, go to a journey of self-growth, there are certain, what stops us to be go on a self a journey of self-growth or development? There are a lot of things, thinking patterns are there. Self-talk is there, negative self-talk is there that actually stops. And common people, actually, we go through all these things. We more into that. So as a leader, mindful leader, I must understand that this is, there can be many negative self-talks in the mind of a person. We expect these people to grow, to become self-independent, to develop. have a next level of understanding. But what happened? We found that at that moment that, okay, it's not possible for every person. For as a leader, I am responsible to understand the situation and try to help that person to come out of that if I want better results from this person. So these roadblocks or the negative thought patterns can be, I failed before, therefore I will fail again. So maybe your some worker is not trying to do new things because this kind of thought pattern may be behind that person's mind. I have no power over how I act or behave. Cannot manage, must not do anything that scares me. I cannot move until my plans are perfect. I can't learn to do things I don't understand. I must reject others before they reject me. So these negative thoughts, not only we have to be our own, mindful of our own thoughts, what's going in my mind, what stops me taking the next step or taking the risk or the challenge, but also the same thing can go into the other people's mind, and there is the possibility that they might have been having more of such kind of thoughts or negative self-talk that demotivates them, that stops them to come forward. You know, most of the time it happens if we want for volunteers to raise their hand. Hardly any hand comes out. Why? There might be all these things behind their thought pattern. Okay, why should I say if I become what? So many things come, I am not perfect for doing this challenge. If I am not able to deliver the right way, I will be become a laughing material for all the people. So what if the boss says, no, you can't do that. So rather than having that rejection, I should not propose in the first hand that, okay, I'm willing to do some work for the organization or take on the responsibility of this project or some event happening in the organization. So as a leader, we have to understand what are my roadblocks, and that same roadblocks can be for the other people as well. So like, see, sometimes what happens, we have learned helplessness from the childhood. Somebody has always, many times our parents, our teachers, they label us. Now the times are different. The teachers and the education system is actually taking into consideration that all that what can happen into the for the in the future of the children. So how do they behave? They are learning about it. But the earlier we know that the education system, we were labeled by the teachers and the parents the same way. So you are not able to. You are not capable. Most of the time we used to hear that this is not your job. So it's helplessness. Whenever something comes, it doubts my capabilities. I will doubt myself, okay, whether I'm able to do it or not. So I have learned this helplessness because of my parents and the teachers told me in the early stages of my life. And knowledge without context, I feel sometimes, okay, I must have to know certain things. But what I do, I read a lot of books. I gather knowledge. But I don't apply it. Maybe I'm scared of applying it, whatever it is. But whatever knowledge, if I accumulate the knowledge, but I do not share it, but I do not implement anything what I learned through my reading or learning, new learning, then it is of no use. I have to understand that, okay, whatever, if I'm gathering knowledge, if I'm having new information, I must share it and apply it in whatever context it is possible. Then there might be some opportunities which we ignore them. We do not identify. There might be some reason because we were not ready to make the change. We were not ready to take the risk. And so it is like, okay, I miss opportunity because I do not have that courage to take the challenge, or I do not have
possible for
okay.
us to take some question and answers
Uh-huh.
Based on what the so I was just trying to inquire whether by what time we could start taking question answers so that everybody gets advantage of having interacted with you as well. Thank you.
Thank you so much. So just 3 minutes more, I will wind it up.
Okay.
So, and sometimes we do not have the proper vocabulary to articulate. You know, as a teacher, I have learned to explain things to students in the various ways. I'm using different kind of words so that they understand better. And the same thing happens when you are in the leadership position. To what we want to say, we should have a, you know, good vocabulary to make alternative use of the alternative words. And the same thing may happen to our colleagues that they do not have the proper vocabulary to make us understand what they want to intend to say to us. And then people stay in the comparison. The more we compare ourselves, the more self-esteem goes down and we are not able to be positive and take, you know. So this is something which stops us growing in our personality or personal development. And then, as I told you, the destiny attitude is the, and then we have negative motivation. I'm not clear, I'm lost, it is, I can't decide. So many negative things are there that actually become the roadblocks of. Then there are different types of mindsets also. The kind of mindset as a leader or the person I have that will impact, and specifically it is important for a leader to understand that mindset is maybe fixed mindset. Once I am failure, I'm always a failure, nothing will work. Or the growth mindset is taking challenges and trying new things. And then we have a scarcity perspective, lack of resources. I can't do because these things are not available to me. I don't have time to do that. And then abundance mindset that, okay, there's a lot of opportunities. There is some way of doing something. So we have, you know, okay, I can find out sometime. So there is some positive and negative mindsets also. Then our outlook, how we look at the things, we take challenges, we look at the problems which are coming up, or we look at the opportunities that will be created. And we are focusing on problems, or we try to find out a solution-oriented mind. We talk about, discuss about problems. Or sometimes some people are there who they think, okay, we were part of the problem. Let us think about the solution. So what kind of mindset as a leader you have? Or are you a reactive or a proactive attitude? So like, you know, before the problems come forth, you take responsibility what's happening and you try to take steps that can help you take out of the you know, problematic situation. And suboptimal, or yeah, maybe not, you know, some, you always want somebody's validation for that. Or are you that, okay, I do my best, I know whatever the result comes, I will, my responsibility is to give my best rather than looking for a validation from the other person. Or I am an egoistic person as a leader, or I am agile person. I transfer, delegate my responsibility, or my perspective is that, okay, my way or the highway. What kind of a mindset I have? Or am I hard? It is hard for me to take decisions. Or if I, there may be my colleagues who can't take decisions. So what I do about it? So do I learn some techniques where I can take decision? One of them is regret minimization. So the most important thing is that when we connect with people, we take care of all the things which we have already spoken about. So the shift is that more directive or authoritarian leader. So we have to become non-a directive person. Rather than teaching or instructing, we can ask a question. We can encourage them to have their own suggestions, so their own point of views onto that. And we, in a conversation, we can have, you know, bring in immediacy. Okay, go into the detail, whatever they say, what happens then? Can you tell me something more about it? And we can, like, you know, provoking thought process and discussions in the, so winning the heart of the people, connecting with their heart, making heart-to-heart connection. And then what happens when we follow this process, we can have mindful influence on the people there. And they can, you know, they start trusting us. And when they trust us, we can easily influence them according to the usefulness of the organization. Thank you. Sorry. Actually, yeah, we didn't,
No,
when we
no.
go on to that.
No, thank you so much. I think we all need to take your advice and take a deep breath, because I
Thank
think
you.
you've been at this for almost 80 minutes now, non-stop. So it just shows your passion and commitment for the subject and taking us through a whole roller coaster of understanding mindfulness, right from the basic core things of, things like observation, reasoning, and understanding, to its core components, which are attention, intention, and influence from attitude. So I think you've almost conducted a spot MBA in mindfulness for all the people who are there. So thank you very much. In fact, it was what you were saying was getting very interesting. But unfortunately, my apologies that I had to come in and become a little bit more mindful of the time, because I know
Yes,
that there's a
I know.
little bit
Yes, because what happens when we prepare sometimes, but it seems like how I will be able to speak such a long time. So that initially, yes, this is also in the mind. We have that, okay, whether I will be able to, because normally as a teacher we give a 40 minutes lecture.
So I thank you so much for sharing this entire journey on mindfulness with us. I just thought that maybe we should open out and let everybody unmute themselves and ask you any questions that they would like to address. So any one of you, whoever has any questions that you would like to address to Rashmi ma'am, kindly unmute yourself and free field to ask. Okay, I think everybody's trying to simply digest the plethora of information that you had presented in a marathon session. So right now they're just trying to imbibe. Yes. Is there anyone who has a question? Because I thought that someone
You
had
can
sent
put
a
it in the
message.
chat if there is any question
Yeah,
or something.
there was one question which had been sent to me,
Okay.
but I think that person has is not there in the group. So maybe I'll ask the question on that person. The question that was raised by one of the participants was that, the formula that you suggested is that whenever there is an input given to you in some sort of, say, somebody says something to you, okay, you were suggesting that we should listen. We should understand. We should, try to put ourselves in the other person's shoes before responding.
Yes.
So in short, what you are saying is that mindfulness means that you need to get a complete understanding of the situation where the other person is coming from before you actually respond to that person. So you need to take a pause. So the question being asked was that in the strongest bonds in this world are amongst friends. Okay. And in friends, if you need to think and react, then there's a whole loss in spontaneity of the relationship. So, how does mindfulness actually play a role where you are engaging with people that you have an integral bond with?
Yeah, at times it happens. Yes, I agree that the friends bonds are very integral, and you are free to without listening saying anything or taking assumptions. But it is a practice for self-growth. It's not that you take a pause, but you can watch your words, which might not get hurting at that moment in the flow of, because when we learn to keep in the flow at the times, it is difficult to control ourselves taking out from that flow. So yes, there are spaces when you enjoy this moment, you are in the present. So mindfulness is being in the present moment. If you are enjoying that moment with your friends, so why to becoming so much of thoughtful and dragging yourself? But it is always sometimes in the friends, when you grow and mature, you realize that there were certain things which were not spoken by your friends because of the integrity of the relationship, because you were so one and the part and parcel of each other, that so there are certain things which are not shared into that also. So mindfulness becoming that, okay, whatever is happening between you, just be there, be attentive, not to be swayed take your mind to any other place, or whatever. I know people, friends, they say negative to each other also. They don't trust them, whatever they say. Yeah, I know you can't do that. So there are so many degrading things which we speak about it. But if we become a little, being in the present moment, enjoying that moment, and also taking care that, okay, at later on sometime, it won't impact the personality of this person.
I get what you're saying. You're saying that if I enter a room where my friend is the managing director, but was my classmate 50 years ago, I can't address him in the same way that I addressed him 50 years ago. I have to curtail myself and take a back step and, understand the problem. So, okay. Thank you. Thank you for that response. Any other questions anybody has? Okay. So, I think, ma'am, we are just about touching 5:30 p.m. So, firstly, on behalf of BMA, let me thank you very much for sharing this knowledge with us and making us a part of your learning process and the journey. I think it is extremely going to be extremely helpful and critical to many of us who can start practicing mindfulness. And I look forward to be able to have some more detailed sessions where you can actually conduct workshops and get people into the habit of understanding and practicing mindfulness. So we look forward to that. This is just a trailer. I think the main movies are yet to be released. So we BMA looks forward to having more inputs and to the benefit of our members. So thank you so much, and thank you all for being here with us today and participating in this excellent webinar on mindfulness delivered by Rashmi Sharma ma'am, and look forward to your continuous support and engagement with BMA.
Thank you so much,
Good.
sir. I'm really, fortunate and privileged that I was given an opportunity through the platform of prestigious organizations like Bombay Management Association. So I'm really proud of this moment now. And
Thank you. So are
thank
we.
you so much
Yeah.
because it has encouraged me to,
Yeah.
increase my confidence there that, okay, I know that all learning, you are such a great learned people here are. Who have seen the real corporate world for such a long period of time and have a lot of great experiences which we can learn from. So thank you so much for
Yeah.
considering me capable of doing this session, taking this
Thank you.
session. Thank you so
I'm
much.
sure there's
Thank
no end
you,
to learning, and we look forward.
dear.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so
Thank
much.
you,
Thank you, everyone.
everybody. Take care, be safe, and enjoy the rest of your week.
Thank you, sir.
Good day.
Thank you, everyone.
Thanks.